You see your opponent, you see your fighter, you see a way that your fighter can lose this fight. You know what I'm saying? With me, I can see Terrence Crawford can possibly be outworked. And won't be able to find that shot all fight. You know what I'm saying? Errol Spence can stay in his face and stay in his chest, and Crawford have a problem finding his shot for 12 rounds. How would you see Terrence Crawford getting off on Spence and possibly winning the fight? What's your feel of the fight?
I'm glad you made that point. Like you said, we're not going to make predictions. You know, I favor Spence, you favor Crawford. We're not going to get too deep into it. But one thing I have been thinking about after the fight was made, I sat down and thought about it for like 30 minutes. I was driving home and I was thinking about both styles. And the room for error for both fighters is so slim. And I'm going to tell you why. For Errol Spence, he doesn't have that electric power that can change the fight in one shot. He's a thumping, heavy-handed, beat you up, wear you down type fighter. Terrence Crawford has that. He can be down on the card and one shot can stop you in your track and you be holding on trying to survive the rest of the round. That's not really Errol Spence style. So for 12 rounds, Errol Spence could be, you know what I'm saying, getting too confident, you know, doing his 70, 80 punches around, and one exchange, one bad exchange in that 12 round, and the fight can change. He could get less aggressive. He could never recover from being hurt, or he could get stopped right then and there. But Terrence Crawford, his run for error is so small is because it's gonna be very hard for him to win a decision, because he's a counterpuncher that's gonna wait, and Spence is not gonna wait. He's gonna throw 70 to 80 punches around. So even though in between those punches, I think Terrence Crawford's gonna land some significant shots. But if the other guy is working, he can steal a lot of rounds. And it could cause him to get behind on the card because his motor is so high, he's punching so much that the judges and the fans may look at it and say, even though Terrence Crawford is more effective, Spence is more busy, so I gave him that round. So that's the problem that Terrence Crawford gonna have. So I think they both have a major problem, because Spence got to be on his P's and Q's, because I put him as thinking the fight, he's going to get hurt. I think at some point he's going to get hurt, and I don't know how he's going to react and what's going to happen after that. And for Terrence Crawford, with the pressure, the relentless pressure, if he's not able to get a good counter shot, or he gets down 6-3 through 9 rounds, and it's the 10th round, and now he got 3 rounds, he know he down by 3 rounds, and he can't wait to counter. Now he got to come out of his countering and become more of the aggressor to a guy that's bigger than he is. So it's both, I see it can go both ways. So that would make this fight so intriguing, because I see both of these guys having a small window for error that they both have to be on the A game on July the 29th.
I agree with some of that. The only thing I disagree with is I don't think Spence is throwing 70, 80 punches against Crawford. I don't think he's going to be able to find the confidence to throw. Spence is a very confident thrower. Spence don't waste movement. He don't waste punches. And it's gonna be hard for him to find not only his range, but his confidence. The way Crawford fights is nowadays he don't do as much lateral movements he did back in his 135 days. He don't move around the ring a lot like he used to. But he does these subtle movements, which Sean Porter figured out. He does these little subtle movements that he gets himself just out of range or just to the side of you, to where you're not as confident throwing your punches. You know what I'm saying? And then when you come in, you do get in your range, you do get close, you know, he'll make it rough for you on the inside. So you look how you did it, Sean Porter. I think that this kind of the similar shot that he caught Sean Porter with, it won't be the uppercut like he caught Sean with when Sean ducked down to it. It won't be a shot like that. I think it's gonna be more like a looping overhand right. It's gonna catch Earl. But it's gonna be in a moment where Crawford is slightly out of range, not out of range because they're about the same size. I say slightly to the left, to his left, to Earl's right, to where that shot would land, but he'd be out of the line of pocket from Earl. I mean, if you look how Ugas was catching Earl kind of similar way, if you watch how, I forgot the Spanish guy, I think it was Garcia, how he was catching Earl with uppercuts, it's kind of the same way. That's how I see this fight going. So I don't see Earl, you know what I'm saying? I think Earl know the same thing. I don't see Earl, you know, setting up things with punches like he did against Sean Porter or Carol Brook or Adrian Peterson. You can't set up a shot. You can't set up a punch with punches for a guy who's not going to be there. So I think Earl is going to be more jab heavy and front foot heavy until he gets Crawford in a position where he can't use that lateral, that quick lateral step that he normally do. And one reason why I know that's true, because Derrick James, if you listen, watching how Derrick James talk about the fight, he give you hints without giving you hints. I mean, okay, I forgot who gave him the interview, but somebody asked Derrick James what they think about Crawford and Crawford's style. What about Crawford's style would give Earl problems? He said he's a good athlete. Basically, what that means is he sees the same thing that I see. He sees that quick step out of range as you throwing. So think about how he caught Sean Porter. He caught Sean Porter by taking steps back subtly out of range and then stepping in with the uppercut. He did that several times throughout the fight. Same way he caught pretty much everybody he knocked out in at welterweight. He caught everybody the same way. He caught Carol Brook coming in with an unseen shot, being slightly off the angle, off the tilt. So that's what I see. I think Derrick James see that. So I'm interested to see how both Derrick James and Bomack, how both of these guys put up with that fighter and come up with game plans, you know, to counteract what you said earlier in the video, how both these guys' weaknesses are each other's, the other guy's strength. So both these trainers, man, got a hard training camp to go through and trying to get that guy to not only be confident in the game plan, but to also have more than one game plan, especially when it comes to Earl.